So hello again, everyone. It's been running off in one day, hour and a half lecture, now another hour of warm-up labs. So I asked this already, but it looks like a lot of you have started, right? So this is probably not the first time you're looking at the homework. The way we're going to do this is we're going to go over the spec, but this homework, as you might have noticed, is a few things that can be a little tricky. Scales, putting the axis in the right place, getting the bars the right size, that's a common thing that people kind of get tripped up on, and we're going to talk a little bit more about the scale band, which is what we advise that you use for the years instead of an ordinal scale, and I'll explain why when we get to that. Even though, for the most part, I'd rather we hold off on technical questions until the end, like, oh, my code isn't working, do feel free to interrupt me with more generic questions that can be helpful for everyone so that I don't go through the whole thing and you got stuff halfway through. Okay? And, the idea was to have sketched out this thing. So I sketched out this example on the axis stuff on the iPad and wanted to reflect it while we could talk. That didn't work, so I would just have a static image. When we get to that, it was not going to be as exciting as I had planned. Okay, so the idea is, and I actually have the, well, I don't have the solution up and running. So the idea is you guys are going to be working with map data with a slightly more complex bar chart and information panel that updates with the information of whatever the year, the current year that we're looking at. We're using the classes like we have done in previous homeworks, and the main class that controls everything else is the bar chart, because that's where the user interacts, right? User makes a selection on the bar chart, that updates the map, and updates the information panel. So a lot of the bulk of the coding, with the exception of rendering and drawing the map, is really done inside the bars. the bar chart. So let's walk through this again to make sure I don't forget anything. So the bar chart pretty much allows us to see how much, what over the years, how these World Cups have changed in attendance, number of goals, and number of games. So, right, so we have a drop-down menu here, very similar to what you guys had in homework 3, where if you picked a different quartet, a different data set, you would see the bars change. Now we're picking a different attribute, and we're seeing the bars change. A technical note on this, and this has come up already in a lot of Slack questions, it came up in the lecture today, which is this idea of we no longer have these strings that we know exactly what we want. We want, depending on what the user picks in this drop-down menu, is what is going to dictate the data that's going to be displayed in the map. Now, hopefully, most of you know that we can't use the dot notation for that, right? Because we have a variable that holds what the user chose, we're instead going to use brackets, right? So instead of you saying data dot attendance, we're going to do data brackets my user selected variable that happens to be attendance when the user clicks something else. Okay. So anyway, so that's the bar chart and what it does. The world map, pretty much, we're going to draw this base layer very much like we did in class. You probably can't see too because of the projector, but there's a reticule on there, just like we did today. And then we're coloring them according to whether they were first place, second place, those are the two, yeah, first place and runner-up. And then the info panel just updates with a list of all the teams that year, who was the host, the winner, and so forth. Now, if you look at the what you guys get is bare bones, so you have the styles and the legend and everything like that, and notice that you already have the titles that you need here. You don't need to regenerate these, you don't need to append these, you just need to select them and then add the text below them. So you're going to add underneath winner, what the name of the winner was, underneath host, and so forth and so on. So the data, the code that goes into the info panel is pretty short. Once you know which year the user selected, you're passing that year in, and you're getting that data, and you're appending text to each one of these, if it's the first time. And if it's not the first time, you're updating the text. Right? So one of the common things that we saw last year was, if you just do the append, it works beautifully the first time, because you have nothing there. But if you keep appending, that means your list just keeps growing and growing and growing. So this is one of those places, again, where you want to make sure that you're updating, entering, and doing the exit appropriately. Otherwise, it'll work great on load, not so great when you change.
So this first time you have appending, and the other time you have exit, and then update.
So the fact that it only appends on the first time is implicit with the logic of the enter, the update, and the exit. You don't check, hey, global variable, has the user clicked on something? Yes, and then no. The idea is you take in the data, and if it's the first time, that means everything is going to end up in what selection? The enter, right? That's the first time, that's like new stuff. If it's the second time, then those exist already. So those are going to be in the selection and the updates, but the enter is going to be empty. So when you do append on enter, nothing's going to get appended. So it's kind of like, it's the implicit logic behind the way these works. You don't have to control for whether or not it's the first time the user clicked. So, you know, the basics, you put yourself at the top, make sure that it runs through the validator. These are the files that we give you. They're empty for the most part. You don't have to worry about anything else. This is just data and the figures and stuff that went into this. At this point, hopefully everyone can run a server, a little Python or some version of a server that will serve up their files on local host 8080. And so we already take care of the reading for you. So if you go the reading in the files, so if we go over to, I'd be very careful not to click on that. We have here. So we're pretty much just going through the data that we read into the CSV file, and this has come up a few times. Who can tell me what all of these little pluses are doing?
Changing the number.
Who's making sure that those are numbers and not strings, right? Because the default's a string. It will coerce to a number if you try to do math on it. So if you do a d.win1 plus 2 and console.log that before ever putting a plus in front of it, you do get a number. But because we don't have to wait until that coercion is made, we just force it into becoming a member with those pluses. Then we pretty much break up the list into an array of the ISO and the names. The ISO are unique number identifiers, right? And the names are just strings. And so the ISO are better used as keys because they're guaranteed to be unique. There's no strings, no funky characters. So they're just a nice way of having a unique value for each one, which is something that will be very useful for you when you're creating your map. So here we create a new instance of the information panel and the world map. Who can tell me when I put new map or new info panel, what is the function that is getting called? The constructor, right? So inside map, this is what gets called when I do new map, right? And this may be pretty obvious to a lot of people, but just to make sure that you understand that anything that gets put in there gets run when you create a new instance. And if you create more than one instance, let's suppose we have four maps, one for each data type, every time you ran it, it would create a new projection or create a new this or a new that.
And what does the disturbance?
Does anyone know what is this?
An object.
Yeah, it's an object. Which object is it? The map object. It's itself. Okay. That means that you now created a projection that is associated to that map. And the reason it's associated to the map is because we may want to create a new map with another projection.
Is there any alternative that we don't use this instead? We use something like map log projection or something like that. Any other thing other than this?
No, because what you're doing here conceptually is you're creating an attribute that is associated to that object. So map.projection would be, if you already had, you're saying if you could define it outside, then you would do a map attribute. You're right. I thought you were saying map as a library. If you create my map equals new map, right? If you then say my map.projection equals, yes, it will change the attribute from the outside. But we don't want to have to enforce that the user make that call later, and so we're doing that for you. Create a map and we'll add a projection on for you. Okay, that's what that's doing. You could do the same thing from the outside by doing that. Just one more thing. When you use it from the outside, you're saying map if that's the name of the object you created, not the map as the class, because the class is like a blueprint to create these objects. Okay? Make sure I ran through everything in the script file. So you create a new info panel, a new map, and then you're loading in the data that's going to make the world map. That's a JSON file, that's a GeoJSON file, very much like what we looked at in class today. And so your first job is to go in here and actually fill this out, drawing the world map. So if we go back to the map file, you'll see that draw map is empty. I said first, but it says part four. Maybe I'm going a little bit out of order. This is not necessarily. Oh, that's right. We do the bar charts and we do the info panel. But these are separate. If you wanted to do the map first, it doesn't really link to it. It just wouldn't update just yet. So when you do go to do the map, you can use very much the examples that we talked about in class today. This world here is your JSON file, and then you're going to use that to create the paths and actually just draw that background. At this point, you're not coloring it in, you're not putting any circles on top of it, there's no anything, it's just a map. We're creating a new bar chart, and the bar chart is the only thing the user interacts with. So we've made this a global variable. Everything else is only relevant for the bar chart needs to know about the map, the bar chart needs to know about the panel, because when you change something in the bar chart, it needs to call, hey panel, update yourself, hey map, update yourself. The user doesn't get to make any changes to the map or to the info panel, so we don't make those global variables at all. And then, it assumes the default value that we put in here is attendance. So you can see just from that line, from this function call right here, that bar chart has a function called update bar chart, and it takes in a string, and we're defaulting it to attendance. But it can also be goals, it can also be, what's the last one?
Teams.
Yeah, number of teams, I think it was. That one's kind of boring because it doesn't change that much. Matches. And so, when you are implementing your bar chart, this is the string of what is the attribute of your data that you want to plot more. Okay? So this should actually, and this is a nice place to start, the bar charts, because, especially because we kind of took homeworks 2 and 3 very much in creating bar charts. I would suggest this would be your starting point. Shouldn't be too hard. And the issue that people run into here is placing things on the SVG. Because even from homework 3, I'm just throwing these numbers out at this point, I don't remember what homework it was, that we didn't have an access, right? So if you ever did and I actually did this, let me see if I can show you, make sure I get the right direction here. I did a screenshot just to kind of show you. This is from the solution for homework, whatever, right? This is the SVG, and even though you couldn't see it, when you did your bars, you assumed they started 0, 0, there's no space here for axes. That worked because the concept being we scale the bars according to the data. But now we want something slightly fancier where we want to add axes. The moment you add axes, that means you also need to shift your bars over, right? And so, I don't know if I'm gonna jump straight into this discussion yet. I think I'll go through homework and then we'll come back to these specifics. Yeah.
Window.bar chart that defines the global variable.
It is one way of defining a global variable. That's true. The other one would be not to put anything in front of it. Because if you put let, it's confined to block scope, so the closest curly braces. If you put var, it's to this function. And if you don't put anything, it's global. This kind of just defines, like, reiterates the fact that it's global to the user. It just makes it very clear. Window or not? Window dot bar chart or nothing? Just bar chart.
Okay, how about the old thing, like,
these are not global variables because they have a let inside. Right. So they only live inside the closest curly braces, which happens to be the function itself. So in this case, if you did bar or let, it would have the same implication. With ES6, we don't use var almost ever. It works, it will compile, it will run. But we want to do let and const, for the most part, are globals, to make it very clear, to not pollute the global namespace, right? We want to have our variables only be relevant where we need them. Because if you say, for example, x equals 5, because you're using x for something, and you don't realize that you're making it global, and later you use x again, because it's a very common variable, and you don't reset it, the bugs are just endless. So the nice thing about let is that you say, hey, I only need this for now. That means the moment you access this function, they don't even exist anymore. So if you try to access them, it says undefined, which is helpful for you to figure it out. If you had put var, or if you had made them global,
you
access it elsewhere, and it doesn't, and it actually works.
Yes.
One quick note, if you don't put like let or var, then it gives you a reference assignment on undeclared variable.
Oh, you probably have to do, are you, is that nothing, it doesn't default to global.
Right.
Oh, maybe that's a consent side of function. Maybe that's why we actually have to put a window in there. Okay.
And then the construction of this bar chart has 3 parameters.
So if you this is the constructor, right? So if you open bar chart, you'll see that the constructor takes in 3 panels and then sets them as the attributes of that class. Right? Because I was telling you, the bar chart needs to know about the existence of everything. So we had 2 approaches to this, and something Alex and I discussed. Is if you knew that the bar chart has access to things, A, you can make them global, everyone has access to it, it's not as clean, or B, if you know just the bar chart needs it, then you need to pass them in, and the bar chart is the only one that has them as attributes.
I did a selected dimension, not the like, this is the
say that again?
Selected dimension within the updated.
Yeah.
Why does that not need to be declared as a
That's a very, very, very valid, very valid question. The difference is whether an attribute belongs to the class or where it's a parameter to a function.
Okay.
So this changes every time you update it, right? So you could have it where this dot selected dimension is the default student, but then the steps in updating it is update the attribute and then call it. It's only relevant to this function, so we use it as a parameter. Okay, so that's the extended script.js. This is what we provided to you. And the nice thing about you having a little bit is that you can kind of use this cheat sheet to base your implementation on and understanding how you create a new one, although in this case we've already instantiated all the objects for you. The first step, if you're going to draw the world map, I suggest is doing a console.log on your world object. Okay, because then you can kind of see what it looks like. Yeah. Let's go back to the spec. Yeah.
question last week about this. It has choose data function, and also the same function appears in bar chart objects. They are the same for the computer.
They are the same. That's a very good question, and we're going to come to that in just a second.
Oh.
Yeah. So the first thing you're going to do is inside the bar chart, you're going to implement given a selected dimension, create a bar chart. This is very similar to what we've done homework so far. Displays one of these four, and you know that you can use this to access the data from each one of these. Oh, five actually. It's pretty straightforward. There's not much more explaining to do. And then this is where you want to make sure you include x and y axis and tick labels using scales and axis. And then we're coloring the bar based on the chosen attributes. So we're kind of doing a double encoding, right? The height of the bar and the color of the bar. Those are the two things. I'm just wondering when I'm going to stop and talk about accents, but in the meantime, we'll just keep going. So this is what happens when you change the attribute in the drop-down menu. Right? As I was saying, the team is kind of boring. It doesn't change that much. I think matches is pretty boring too. Then goals and attendance are the ones that change more. There are a few cool things about this. See how everything updates and it's just a smooth transition? So you're going to use transitions to include that. If you don't have transitions, I don't know if we include this as extra credit. You won't lose points, I think. I'm saying this and then I'll be held accountable for it. I'm going to send you that recording snippet and make a little meme out of it. I have to make absolutely sure that you didn't say that you lose points. The point is, transitions are super easy to add, right? And so just add.
And on X's?
Yeah.
You can add transitions on X's also.
You can, yes. Okay, so that's what your bar chart is going to look like. The other thing with the bar chart you still need to do is when you click on it, it should turn red. Or any color, we have red for our solution, but just with a different color. And when you click on it, that's what's going to update the map. And that's what's going to update the bars, the side panel. So clicking on it triggers two callbacks, the map callback and the info panel callback. Okay? If we take a quick peek at the map and what the functions are that you have there, this draw map was done before we ever interact with the bar chart, right? So that just has the background there. We have a separate one called update, and this is the one that's going to color it, that's going to add circles and do all the kinds of fun stuff that needs to be updated. So this is the one where you have to be incredibly careful with your enter updates and exits, because every time you move, you change the drop-down menu, it's going to call back, you send in the data that you need to populate the map with, and then this is where you're going to go through, change the color, change where the dots are, and so forth. By dots, I mean these markers. Okay, that's the map. So the info panel is, you pretty much need to, and all this information, this is why I strongly recommend when you get a data file in, is that you do a console.log so you can see what all your attributes are. Unsurprisingly, this, you have the information for who the host was, who the winner was, who the server was, and all the teams in the file that you're reading. So you're pretty much just setting the text attribute to your data. It's very short code. This should take you very little time. Okay. So if it starts getting complicated, you're overthinking it.
Is it okay if you do that by $ to sort of B3?
No.
You should do it by B3?
Yes. Everything that is updating. And here's another thing that you can't do, which a lot of people did out of despair towards the end of the homework, which was D3 select all dot remove, and then you start from scratch. D3 dot select all dot remove gets rid of everything, and then just populates it again. Because what that means is you don't have to worry about exit, update, enter. It sounds like I'm giving you an out, but this is actually me telling you don't do that. Does everyone understand why you can't do that? So it's kind of a cheating thing. One thing that becomes clear that you did that is because you don't have transitions. Because you pretty much wiped your DOM and repopulated, which completely negates the whole thing of updating what was already in the DOM. It works. Because one of the things that people have the most problem with is getting the updates to work right. So you don't forget it. Get rid of everything and populate everything. Don't do that. And it's tempting when you start getting these lists of huge things. Yes, so you want to add a text element, and then, right? It's not d3.text, right? You want to append a text. And this is another thing that's really super annoying.
Yeah, I'm having the same issue everybody.
Oh, yeah? Oh, I don't think I need to check for anything. Here, I'll do, I'll just, Does anyone know the difference between d3.append text inside and outside of an SVG? The answer is there is no text element outside of an SVG. A text, when we do text inside of an SVG for like a label or something, a text is an SVG element. When you have text in the DOM, you just have text inside a P or a div or a, right? There's no text label, open bracket text, right? And that is important to know because if you try to append an SVG text here, there is no SVG here. It's not going to show up. This is just an HTML, a portion of HTML. These are just DOM nodes. This is just, there's no SVG whatsoever. You could append an SVG and append a text to it, but you don't need to, right? Because text, it's the same thing. We usually append SVG text because we want to label an SVG. I'm seeing some confused faces, so I just want to make sure that's clear, right? If you append a P or a span, and then just set the HTML content of it to winner, you're going to see the text winner here. If we do, actually, here's a play. Let me show you this. This is not a text element. This is a header. It's a header element. And inside, we're going to put maybe a list, an LI. So we're going to append an LI, and the content of that LI is going to be our data, which is the list of the winner, or a list of, in this case, the host is just one, but for teams, it's going to be a list, right? So you're going to select your teams, you're going to add an LI. So people are so used to use SVG enough to say, I'm going to append a text, forgetting that the text is only valid, the text element is only valid within the SVG. When you are creating text labels, I can't remember if this one has it, I think it has, inside a map or something, then you're appending a text, okay?
That means that filling the data in the info panel will be through JavaScript.
No, it still is through D3. And I understand the confusion. I think that's important to clarify. D3 doesn't just handle SVGs, right? If we backtrack just a little bit, remember when we appended divs and we set in the very beginning when Alex did those the 90s example with that the numbers with the colors when he didn't use any SVG yet? So D3 manipulates the DOM. The DOM can have SVG elements, but it can also have regular P's and divs and spans, right? D3 does both. Right? When we are dealing with SVGs, which when you think about it, any visualization, the moment you have a circle there, you're talking about an SVG. And we talk so much about that, people forget that you can actually manipulate the basic DOM with it as well. So the info panel, what I'm saying is, only manipulates the basic DOM, still with D3, select, append, everything. But you're not appending text elements, you're just appending lists and IDs, anything that's valid HTML. Okay?
That was the very first example when we were starting the D3.
Yeah.
And was changing the text on the
exactly. Exactly. It's almost too easy that people overcomplicate it and try to add a SVG. Okay?
We didn't add lists also inside that. That was not.
Say that again?
You can add lists also inside.
Yes, and this is what you're going to do for the teams. Because you require a list, so you're going to append LI. And then the content of the LI.
Need the other content LI.
Yes. Okay, so that's the info panel. Just don't get stuck on these tiny little things, because you know, you want to spend your time with the map and the bar chart and so forth. Okay, so then we're going to go on to the map. We're creating the background very much like we did in class. Pretty much you can just use that kind of code to see. You shouldn't have any problems with the boilerplate with like the basic base map. We already gave you the projection and the scaling and everything, so you should be fine. We've already styled countries and team and host for you, so that all you have to do, so actually before you can say what you have to do, notice that they're classes and they define the colors, right? How do you apply this to your element? Attribute class, right? Are you going to assign attribute class to all of your paths? Attribute class host? So you do a D3, select all, and then you gave it the JSON file and it created one path per country. Right? Now you want to assign the relevant class so that it will be styled correctly.
But class is name common
group. That you're right that it's not class name common group. Well, how do you know which name to give? You're kind of you're batch iterating through all of your countries. Whether you give it the class of host or team or countries, everything is countries, right? So you can kind of do all of them dot countries. Not everyone is a host and not everyone is a team. How do you, at what point in your process do you have enough information to know if you should give the class of team or host? Where is that information?
In the way that was passed.
In the data that was passed in, yes. So you're binding, every country is an SVG that gets bound to a data element, right? That's kind of the concept of binding in the world JSON file, those features, with your SVG paths. Okay? When you have access to that data, you are going to use that data to define if you're going to give it a class of team or countries or host. That means there are two ways of setting classes, right? One is dot classed, if you know what it is. So you can select all of your countries, say dot classed, countries true. Okay? That's one way. What's the other way? And maybe this is probably the way you guys have done it more often, because I don't see the dot class getting a lot of nods. Just fine because you're not using it here. How do you set the class of a country to my favorite country? What's the syntax for that? Yes. Dot attribute, and then
class,
and then the name of the class name, right? Do you know when you're giving the radius of a circle, you do dot attribute, or dot, yeah, attribute R 5, but maybe the radius of your circle isn't always 5, and you can actually have the radius of your circle be dependent on the data? You can actually have the class be dependent on the data. My point is that you're kind of used to giving everything the same class. We're taking this a step further here, and we're saying your class now depends on your data. So instead of saying dot attribute class countries for everything, which you will, you're going to say dot attribute class host, and then you have a function that takes in your data, and if d.host equals true, if whatever the logic is, return host. Okay? So the key thing here is the way that you apply these styles to your data to your countries is now data specific. And it's the same syntax that you use for radius for anything that's data dependent.
Class should be a function, you are saying. The parameters of the class should be
yes.
A function.
Yes. So you're no longer, you're doing attribute class just like you did attribute radius or sort of fill or anything, so that the callback can use the data to define what to return. Right? So you can return host, return team, return countries.
Three different loops.
Inside your logic, yes. It could be a ternary, it could be an if loop, yes. And then another thing that's important to notice here is your countries may have more than one class, okay? And that's important because there's something about that attribute class that you may or may not know, which is it replaces your class. So if you say select all countries dot attribute class countries, right? Because we know that all of them are going to be countries, so all the path outlets should be assigned to countries class, so they all have countries. If the next step is you do select all dot attribute class d return d dot host equals true or whatever your logic is, so that you now assign the ones that are host, you lost the dot countries. So what I was going to say, and I actually did not know that you have an add class. I'm
not sure if it's jQuery or JavaScript because I use more jQuery.
Yeah. So it's not D3. But what you can do along those lines is the class. And so this was one of the things, and I wonder if I can write, just to kind of leave it here for you. Does anyone see a marker?
I have a marker.
Oh, you happen to have one. That is a very prepared person. And that is the advantage of using this toggles a class on and off without affecting any of the others to dark, right?
Yeah.
So, okay, so it's dot classed. And then the other one is dot attribute. class D return blah blah blah. This will clear all your classes and because it's pretty much setting the class attribute, right? It's not doing a diff of your previous class with what you're setting now. This replaces it. This toggles only this one on and off. And I'll let you think about which one you should use for countries and which one you should use for templates. But just keep this in mind so you don't understand the setting one. Deletes the others.
You
do need them both. Okay, this is what we were saying before. We use the ID to tag each country. So that way you can select a specific one, right? So if you know the winner was Australia, you don't have to, and please don't, loop through all of the countries. You can just select on that ID. The ID is a nice little tag that we do for each country, so that when you're going through your data and you want to add your circle over the winning country, and I'm sorry, I'm talking about the circle, I realize we haven't really talked about that yet, but the marker that you're going to add on top of the winner and the runner-up, you can actually access this just by using a D3 select on the country with the ID. Okay, so when you update the map, what are the things that we want to encode here? So we're going to use color to encode the participating and the host country. Now remember, you don't have to set the color yourself. We're doing that with the classes. So similar, instead of using the data to set the field, you use the data to set the class. Hopefully that's clear now. It's just a different way of achieving the same thing. The nice thing about this is if you want to change the color, you can just go to your styling sheet and say, yeah, I think I want my host to be a different color, you change it there, as opposed to going through your code and finding the fill attribute. So the more we use classes, the better we separate out the styling from the actual JavaScript stuff. And then the other thing is that we want to add a marker for the winning team and the runner-up. And the marker is a circle. So this is what it looks like. The host is colored blue, all participating countries are this light beige color. The winner is a gold circle, and the runner-up is a silver circle. Okay. The concept of, hopefully from class today, the data maps portion, it became clear that what are separable concerns and what aren't. The process of adding a marker on top of the winning country is completely separate from the process of drawing the map and applying the classes to color them. And those are things you can do separately, but in the end, they overlay each other to tell the whole picture, the whole story. As we said before, we create classes to style the hosting country and the participating countries. Make sure to take advantage of those to style the appropriate path elements. I do want to talk a little bit about the axes and a few things. Let me just make sure I covered it all. And
you're done. Okay. And the scale, so scale of position and continuity that you that allow that invasive only. What was it? Did you got in the class?
Oh, right. No, but we already give you the scale here. So inside the map, and I'm remembering this one. That's the one we give you. The projection. Yeah. Let me just go through the extra credit real quick. So in the extra credit, we actually now have the user interact with the map. You click on a country and it displays the list of all World Cups they've ever participated in. And that is something that gets added to the info panel. So at that point, hopefully you have the skills to update the info panel and to create responsiveness in SVG elements. Because if you click on a bar, it's going to update your map and your info panel. The extra credit is click on a country and that will update the info. A new separate panel just means don't replace the information in the info panel. It can be just below it. That's perfectly
it's
fine.
It's okay to post on, right?
Yeah,
it's really fine. For it's right.
You don't have to create a new data or anything like that. We just mean don't get rid of that one.
Is should also change the bar chart or just in?
Because all we really want to know are what are the World Cups they participated in. It's a pretty straightforward extra credit. I mean, those 10% is not bad. Okay, so what I wanted to use a little bit of time was to talk a little bit about these axes and the scaling and that kind of stuff. And if everyone's okay with that, and then we can actually go back to anything that's not clear. So right. So the idea here is, and you know, I'm going to change it because this is distracting. If you start off with a blank SVG, this is the top left corner here. If you recall, the zero is at the top left, right? And it grows down. So I'm imagining here you have an SVG of height 700 and a width of 600. Right now, before, if you remember this bar chart right here, it didn't matter. We didn't have to move anything over. We did a scale of minus one to flip everything over, but everything started at zero. We didn't have to move anything over with padding or anything. So it looked like that, looked fine. But now, as you can imagine, we need this x-axis and this y-axis. So I just put this smaller thing, it's a little bigger. Now we need to make room for the x-axis and the y-axis and all the labels, right? So some people I've seen just a little tidbits of code or buffer, which I think is a good word. So just so you can kind of understand, we need to push this x-axis up by an amount and the y-axis over by an amount, right? So we can set these variables at the top, and I'm pretty sure we can give you this, right? We can give you this code or any kind of code. So you want to push this up by this much, and so you save a variable that says, this is my y buffer, I'm going to say about 20 pixels, this is a random number, I already found that looks 20, and maybe our x buffer is 30, right? If it makes more sense to you, you can call this the x buffer, but I call it the y because it's in the y direction. That can be a little confusing. Call it whatever you like. Just know that you're going to push this up by this amount, and push that up by this amount. If you don't, what happens is your x-axis is going to lie here, and all your labels are going to be outside of your SVG. So you need to manually push that up. Another thing that happens when you push it up is that when you have your scales, you also need to make sure before, our scales went from zero to SVG width, right? Which meant that our zero bar would be here for x, and it would be here for the last one. We don't want that anymore. We also need to account for this buffer, which means our scales now do not start at zero, they start where?
Buffer.
X buffer, or whatever we call it, right? And then it goes all the way to minus, that's important. It's not the width. If you do the width, it's going to come all the way over here, right? So our x scale now goes from x buffer to SVG width minus x buffer, right? Same thing with the y, but the y is a little different. Instead of using a scaling of 1 minus 1, what we want to do here, and honestly the scaling might even work, but the way I did it for the solution, so it's the way that I know works, is we now want to map. So as far as the size goes, this is very similar logic, right? We want to go from zero to, what's this? It's SVG height minus the y buffer. Right? This is where this.
Oh, yeah.
Right? So those are kind of the extremes of where you want your ranges to be. If we did our y scale to go from zero to, let's suppose, so this is going to be 680, right? If you make your scale go from 0 to 680, this whole thing is 700, then your bar started there, right? So what we got to do is we got to flip it. So instead of your range being 0 to 680, it's now 680 to 0. It just changed the order, and that puts your bars down here, right? Now, the tricky thing is establishing what the y and the height of your bars is once you've done that, right? And this is where I think I'm going to draw, because I was going to draw on the iPad and have it reflect there. So, can someone turn on the light? Since I'm pretty sure this is the last part. Can everyone see this part of the screen? And then we'll find out if you can zoom in here. This is 700.
20. And your y is going from, now you have your 0 here, and say the height of 680 here. Okay. Let's suppose your bar has a value of, well, a value that maps to, so let's suppose this is the value of 300 or something. That's the value of how many people attended or something. When you do a y scale, 300, where is that here? So y scale 300 is right here. Okay, that is this is the value for y scale 300. Let's suppose that our data varies from the smallest bar is 10 and the highest bar is 1,000. Didn't we say that we were going to scale from the so zero instead of 0 to 680, we were going to do 680 to 0. So our domain goes from 10 to 1,000. Right, so 0 goes to, 360 pixels, right. This is what our labels are going to be, right? So because this, the y-axis grows this way, this is 0 pixels, this is 680 pixels, and it is in our mapping that we invert that, right? So because our range is 680 to 0, that means that the smallest bar chart is going to go here at 680, and the largest bar chart is going to be 1,000, which is up here, right? So this inversion of where I drew 680 up here, that's what happens in the when we change the order of our range in our y scale. That's what it's accounted for. So when you do a y scale of 300, this is the value right here. The height of our bar is going to be, so you have the whole thing 700, right? So 700 minus, we're going to start taking away things until we get just the height of the bar.
20,
exactly. So that's going to be this y buffer, or whatever you call this, right? We're going to put 20 here. And we got to take away one more thing to be left over just with this. And what's that? The remaining bit, which is given by? Yep. Y scale of our value. So the height of the bar, and I think that you end up addressing that with two separate ones, but what you're thinking of is here, okay, because I inverted my y scale to go from here to here, you have your whole SVG width minus this padding minus this amount here. This is given by y scale of your value, this is given by x buffer, or y buffer, or whatever, smaller buffer, and this is the height of your bar.
So I kind of understand your solution more where you have two y scales.
Right.
Why wouldn't you need two y scales?
It works, like having two y scales, absolutely. And I realize, and this is honestly something that even, like I was drawing something out of that today to make sure of the explanation, it's cleaner to have one y scale. Because once the logic of using one y scale to both determine the axis and to determine your height makes sense, you're not creating two, updating two, because when you update your data, you now have to go through and update two y scales. It's a purely better coding practices. There's nothing wrong with using two y scales. Okay? And honestly, if that's the only way you can make it work, and maybe you want to go back and change it, that's fine too. Depending on the grades, if pronoun grades are all right, you're screwed, but if...
So, sorry, I got a little confused there, but hopefully this makes sense. And if it doesn't, I can always put something on Slack with the diagram that helps people understand this, okay? You don't do the 1 minus 1. The idea of flipping the 1 minus 1 happened when you changed and you mapped the highest bar to 0 and the lowest bar to 680. This is when that inversion happened.
Okay.
And so, and the one thing I also want to talk about before I let you guys go is the scale band. So the y scale is linear. It just has this kind of inversion thing of the starting here and the height of the bars being defined this way. The other thing I want to talk about is using this scale for years. Sorry, because I didn't hear it because I wanted my solution up on the screen. It's a little... So the temptation here is to use an ordinal scale, maybe. Actually, you know, you can get the lights in the back there. Thanks. But we're not going to use an ordinal scale, and I'll tell you the difference between the two, and there's a really good example here. We're going to use something called a scale band. So the concept of an ordinal scale is you map ordinal values to ordinal values, right? You want the apples to be blue, and you want the carrots to be orange, and so it's a one-to-one mapping of ordinal values, ordinal or categorical values. The scale band is different. It says, I'm going to map ordinal values to numeric continuous ranges. And here's a very simple example that kind of explains this. So here we have a data. We want to do a histogram. The values are the days of the week. Sorry, the keys are the days of the week. So this is ordinal, categorical. And then your value is numeric. And what you want to do is you want to actually make those into bins so that you can have one bar per day of the week. And this is the usage. And I'll actually post this link because I felt like this was the easiest way of understanding it, of how you do it. So your domain is still categorical, but your range is now numeric. So you're saying divide my 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 categories into 200 pixels. And it will create these bands for you. It will say, okay, well if you have 500 pixels for five categories, then you have 100 pixels per category. And then the other thing you want to define is the spacing in between your bars. And that is what the padding is, okay? And I'm going to open up here the actual, this is the API, the D3 API documentation for scale band, and you can see so it creates these bands for you, and then you can set what you want the padding to be. If you want the padding on the outside of your bars to be the same as the padding on the inside of your bars, then you would just call dot padding. And it sets the inner and the outer ones the same ones. If you only want to set the inner, and this is all aesthetic, right? Because the moment you set it, it will create the band to put it in the right place. But the point is, once you have this scale, you can feed in the year, and it will tell you what the pixel value where your bar should go, which is where you're going to place your bars when you do your x, the x values for your bars. Can someone tell me why we don't just use an ordinal scale?
Because you need an array for your range as well that matches this.
Well, that's one thing. Well, let's suppose you decided to do the math yourself. Even though that could work, one thing that you'll see if you actually try is in using an ordinal scale, you're going to have these huge gaps of years, right? Where you have nothing. And this will take care of it for you because it says these are my input years. If you had a one-to-one mapping, then you wouldn't have that problem. But you also have to go through and put in the actual pixel values for each one, right? So this says, okay, I don't care if you have gaps. It doesn't really treat these years as numbers. It treats them as just as each one's a separate category. And then it will give you exactly where the x position where each one of your bands go. You also have to define when you draw your band how thick they are, right? And that is something you can get with bandwidth. This is something that the scale will return to you. So if you call band dot, where is it? Pass it here. It returns the width of the band. And you're going to use this to define what? The width
column.
Of your bars, of your columns, exactly. So by using scale band, you don't have to do the math, how big are my bands going to be, how am I, what is the space in between them, and so forth. So this actually really helps a lot with getting nice bars that fit into your x-axis.
Is there a
question?
Clean way to rotate the x on an axis?
Yes. So the axis has the same context, it's the same idea. Once D3 generates the axis for you, if you do an inspect, I don't have an axis there. They're just text values, right?
Yeah.
So you can get your access, select all text, and then apply an attribute transform rotate ID.
I tried that, but it, like, I don't know where it's rotating from, and I think it's on this side, so it's kind of shift over a little bit.
So you might have to do a translate of a little something, right. But, although I don't remember actually.
I thought that's the way I was going to go about it, but I was wondering if there's like a cleaner way that.
Give me 1 second as I go through the solution and see if there's anything else, because this was from last year, I'm pretty sure. No, we do a translate. So we rotate and then we translate it by the vector buffer value, so you have a little bit of a tweak. Because it does rotate around the not in place kind of thing. Okay, let me see if there's anything else I want to cover. Oops.
After 1938,
yep.
So in
that case. But that shouldn't change, right? I mean, the fact that there's a gap in the data because we're using scale bound shouldn't matter. Because what you're doing is you're telling the scale, hey, these are the years I have, make bands out of them.
Okay.
But the, if your 1930 ends up here or there, is you can either sort your data, or you can say, hey, this is my range, but map it to the other way around. Map it from here to there. Those are two possible solutions.
So both are acceptable, right?
Yeah.
You are saying that reverse the domain also.
That's one way of solving the problem that they're not. Is you reverse the, not the domain, the range, what you're mapping to. So you're saying instead of putting the lowest value at zero, put the lowest value at my SVG with minus buffer, and put the highest value at my buffer. Not at zero, but the buffer. You want this space here. Okay?
How do you, transitions on the axis? I was trying to do that. I don't know if you give it.
So you do a transition, and then you do a call y-axis. So the thing that actually applies the axis is the dot call.
Okay.
Right? And so if you just do a dot call, it switches the axis and it updates it. But because you want that process to be transitioned, you do a dot transition and dot duration, call y-axis. Okay?
You can't use ordinal time frame because from 1938 to 1950 is a long
You can't use what?
Ordinal time.
No, exactly.
But the time difference is more so.
You can't use linear because of that. The ordinal one would require that for every year you would have a category or a number, and right now we don't. So scale bands is doing that for you. Okay. I'm trying to think if there's anything else I remember people getting stuck on last year that I didn't make sure we don't. So yeah, making sure that these, and if you have to draw it out, these buffers are right and so forth.
The scale kind of takes care of the text, right? It will take it only from an input. It will give a text for every input.
Yes. Yes, because, and it's not the scale band that does that, it's the axis, right? So what you're doing is you're creating a new axis bottom for x, dot scale is the y band. And the scale and the axis talk to each other to know where the ticks are. If you get, there's a dot ticks, if you wanted to say add more ticks. But if you just let the default, it will create one tick per output of your scale band. You guys are office hours tomorrow. We have a bunch of it, 4 straight hours. There's no excuse not to come from 12 to 4. run out control to 2, I'll take his leftovers and keep going until 4. And then there's office hours for trans tomorrow, 3:30, and then starting, that's it. And then I also won't be here next Thursday because my brother's wedding, so I'll do it Wednesday as well. Just keep an eye on Google Calendar for my office hours. They're a little bit more all over the place. And then 2 more homeworks, and you guys are done with homeworks, and you can do the projects.